their quarterback, Peyton Manning, who provides confidence. Georgia linebacker Randall Gotfried wants him confused. Manning is the catalyst. Gotfried wants him collared. The frenzy to come, the two collide. Different missions, same objective, find a way to win. Game face, focus, raise intensity. The hunter, Gotfried, his last chance to stop Manning, to stop Tennessee. The hunted Manning at the swirling eye of this orange storm we call Neyland Stadium. Hi, everybody. I'm Ron Franklin, along with Mike Gotfried, and welcome to one of the most special places to spend a Saturday night during college football that you can find. This is not a mohair jacket. It's the hair standing on my arm underneath. That's how inspirational it is. Mike Gotfried, I think a couple of keys that we need to talk about that have to happen for Georgia in this football game tonight. They've got to stop turning the ball over against Tennessee. They've killed themselves the last 3 years with that, and plus the fact they must be able to run the football. They didn't do that very well last year either.
Ron, the key in this ball game is the team that runs the football the best wins this game for two reasons. One, you keep the other offense off the field, but the other reason is both have young quarterbacks. Peyton Manning, even though he's played a lot, is still a young quarterback. Mike Bobo, the Georgia quarterback, comes in here tonight into a crowded stadium here, Tennessee people. This is the first chance he's had to play on the road against a tough crowd and a tough football team. Neither coaching staff wants to put that weight on either one of these quarterbacks, so they'd like to get their running game going early.
So the idea is to take the pressure off these youngsters. Bobo had an outstanding first game last week against South Carolina, and particularly in the second half when this offense really came alive. But as Mike mentioned, that was a very friendly and neighborly crowd that he had of 85,000 down in Athens. I'm afraid there are a few more hostile folks among these 96,000 on the banks of the Tennessee River tonight here in Knoxville. Juan Daniels, number 12. Bryce Hunter also joins him as one of the deep safeties. And Jeff Hall will pick it off. Georgia-Tennessee 1995 is underway. Into the end zone, so it gives us an opportunity. Let's do the Russell Athletic starting lineups for Georgia on offense. Robert Edwards, he was a defensive back this time last year, but he scored 5 touchdowns against South Carolina. They think they'll let him stick around for another week. Wide receivers, Bryce Hunter. He'll go anywhere to catch it. And on the offensive line, there are 3 5-year players on this O-line. Paul Taylor graded out the best last week. First carry goes for 3, 4, and almost 5. And here are the starters on defense for Tennessee. The man to watch, number 1, Leonard Little. He's a junior college transfer. He has great speed. He was a linebacker, but they're using him at defensive end. Speaking to the linebackers, Tyrone Hines, he was suspended last week. He's back now, a preseason All-SEC selection. And in the secondary, an improved area, Raymond Austin, big play guy last week, had 9 tackles in their opener. Has the speed to turn the corner. As you see, Little will knock him out of bounds, but Mike, he has the first down. And there is the difference. He does have the speed to turn the corner.
The two things I've noticed right off the bat, Georgia is opening up with some real big line splits by their offensive line, and the ball's being given to Robert Edwards very deep in the backfield. He did a nice job of cutting that one all the way back against the grain.
That's good for 11 yards and the initial first down for the Georgia Bulldogs. First pass by Bobo. Out in the flat, has it complete. That's Marseille Simpson, and he will take it almost to the 50-yard line. They're spotting down at the 49 as Terry Thayer comes over to make the hit on him.
Look at these offensive line splits by Georgia. They're trying to set up. Look at the splits here between the guards and the center and the guards and the tackle. And that's to open up the line a little bit to make that defense wide enough to give Robert Edwards some running area.
Mike, get it on your mind, because after the next play, I want to ask you, what does Tennessee do to counter that? We'll get to that after this snap. Bubba sprints out to the right, delivers his pass complete, and that's good for another Georgia first down as Mack Dixon is on the receiving end and Gaines and Jenkins on the tackle.
Good question, Ron. What you have to do is you have to take the split sometimes. You can't always move out with them. You get line charges where you take the gaps or you send the linebacker through one of those gaps. Make them tighten up those splits a little bit.
Selma Callaway, number 32. He's a sophomore running back. Comes in replacing Marcy Simpson. Quick count again. Edwards will take it for a couple up the middle, and let's go down to the sideline and check in with Mike Adamley. Mike.
Well, obviously, Ron, with those five touchdowns, the way he's started tonight so far, Robert Edwards has all the necessary ingredients to be a great running back. You start with vision, peripheral vision. A lot of his yardage last week against South Carolina came on cutback runs. He's also got speed. He's a legit 4-4 40 guy in the 40. He's in the open field. He can run away from people. If he has a shortcoming, it's last week he got a little careless with the football against South Carolina. And you talked about those turnovers and how important they can be.
Juan Daniels over the middle. And right now, they're running just enough to keep Tennessee honest. And the passing game is going great guns.
This is a very designed, nicely designed drive by Georgia. Greg Davis, the quarterback coach, is able to trying to keep Tennessee off balance a little bit. Good mix between the run and the pass to Juan Daniels.
So they move the chains again. First down at the 22 of the Volunteers. We'll go with Edwards. Good block at the middle. Has five, has 10. Cut it off at about 13 yards for Edwards as Leonard Little will make the stop along with Raven Austin. But Robert Edwards, the junior from Tennille, is ripping apart the Tennessee defense.
Robert Edwards is going to start to the right and cut back. He gets a real nice block out of the left guard, Paul Taylor, number 52. Again, those big line splits opening up some good holes for Robert Edwards here early in the ball game.
It's a first and goal. Edwards again. Off the left side, he will score. And the Georgia Bulldogs only need 3 minutes to put it in the end zone.
When we were at the hotel last night at the University of Georgia, you felt a confidence that the players had and the coaching staff had. And that is permeated here in this ballgame. They had a nice first drive.
Cannon Parkman knocks home the extra point. 12 minutes, 4 seconds left to play in this opening quarter. And Georgia has stormed down the field to a 7-0 lead. We'll be right back. Seven to nothing, Georgia. Mike, are you surprised with the ease that Georgia took that ball and went right down the field?
Well, I think you have to, but when you look last week, Bill Lewis, former Georgia Tech coach, is here tonight, and he said East Carolina averaged 10 plays a drive last week against this defense. So they moved the ball also.
Niles Silva, 5 yards deep, and he'll go down on one knee. So let's check the starters for the Tennessee Volunteers tonight on offense. Jay Graham, he got his first start last week, and he set a record in doing so, 144 yards. The receivers, this is a good group. Nilo Sylvan, who you just saw, very talented receiver and return man. But the offensive line could be as good as any they've had here. Jason Lehman is the bluest of those blue chips up front. But some pro scouts have said there may be as many as 4 kids on this offensive line that wind up playing on Sunday. Play action, slip screen. Silva, and he's going to take it for an 11-yard gain. And here are the folks that will try to stop him tonight in the Georgia defense. Travis Stroud, very active and strong at that nose guard position, but they will sub a lot up front. Linebackers, well, it's led by Zeus. Randall Godfrey, lighter, but much stronger this year. And in the secondary, Torrey Jackson. He's the quarterback and the hitter back there. This could be a problem area, though, for Georgia, and one of the areas that they want to keep a close eye on.
I feel like they're going to be good in the secondary, but they're young.
Takes it out close to the 40-yard line. He's going to be short of the first down. by about a half yard.
Ron, I've always said, and you've heard me say this almost every week, good teams want to answer a score. They don't want to wait. They want to, when they get the ball, they want to answer the score with points of their own. Peyton Manning, the young quarterback of Tennessee, coaches are telling me he studies the game more than any player they've ever had.
Well, he's an outstanding youngster, but this is a fired up group. This guy right here, particularly Godfrey, wants to stop him tonight. Fired up group of Georgia Bulldogs. Manning gonna go on top. Got a man complete at the 16, Joey Kent.
You watch this play now, you're going to see a one receiver route. Nobody else is in the route. It's a play action fake with just one receiver. They're going to get good protection. Everybody else is blocking. You got one man on a route on the post. You're going for the home run. Joey Kent with a great catch against Buster Owens.
That's 45 yards. And then they come back with a running play for a couple of yards. Rick Marshall makes the hit on Jay Graham.
We talked to Peyton Manning yesterday, and one of the things he told me, I said, the coaches say you study film more than anybody else, and he said, Chuck Knoll, he's quoting pro coaches, he said, he always said, pressure is what you feel when you don't know what you're doing. He said, I'm going to know what I'm doing. My dad's taught me work ethic and studying films.
Second down line to make is the six. With a head of steam. Stroud trips him up. He's inside the 10-yard line. It's going to be Tennessee with a third down, and they'll need a couple. That was Chester Ford out front blocking. Mike, the other thing that has helped young Manning so very much in the summertime is that he told me on Thursday after practice that he spends time with three defensive backs that are playing the NFL and a couple of wide receivers, Clarence Verdan and Troy Tunnell, who lived out of New Orleans, and every morning at 8 o'clock at Tulane, he's the quarterback.
Well, it has to help just practicing with those players.
Here comes the blitz. Manning avoids it. He's going to run. At the five, he will score. Well, as you can see, the youngster will not be on the U.S. 400-meter relay team, but he's growing so fast. I think the speed will come in the next 2 years for him, but he's fast enough to get out of harm's way.
He caught him in a blitz, and on the blitz, he made him pay with the scrambling touchdown.
Jeff Hall with the extra point.
Good teams answer scores. Tennessee's a good football team. You're going to see both inside linebackers blitz. Now there's no one on the quarterback on the blitz. Peyton Manning into the corner of the end zone for the touchdown.
Peyton Manning on the phone. I'm sure talking to David Cutcliffe, the offensive coordinator upstairs here in the press box. Bryce Hunter and Juan Daniels back at a dual safety. Jeff Hall again. 8 yards deep. He will not return it. We got a situation down here in Tennessee that two scoring drives tied at seven. Both were 8 yard runs, both were 80 yard drives, and both took 2:56 to score. Edwards, it's good. He's got one man to beat, and he will be caught and tackled at the 15-yard line. It's Deron Jenkins who finally brings him down.
Ron, I was watching the sidelines. Ray Golf was running behind him. He couldn't go step for step with Robert Edwards, but he was behind him. But Ray Golf is the man that made the decision to move Robert Edwards from corner. Here's the speed of Robert Edwards getting in the secondary. Deron Jenkins, good angle, made the tackle.
Well, Robert Edwards made the switch the last week of spring training. And he said, coach called him into his office and he said, it scared me. I thought I'd done something wrong. And he said, we're going to change it from defensive back to running back. 65 yards on that run. Marcy Simpson will take it for a couple down around the 13-yard line, and Bill Duff comes up from defensive tackle to make the hit on him.
Head coaches have to make those kind of decisions because he was going to be a great defensive back, but Ray, as you said, called him in and switched him. They only had 4 days left in spring practice. The second day was at running back. They actually told him the plays. They said, this is going to be an ISO right. He gained 200 yards in the scrimmage. They knew they had something special.
Look at this, Mike. He's got over 100 yards already. We got 8:05 to play opening quarter. Troy Kersey is checked into the backfield, number 20. He gets the handoff. He gets banged hard, but his offensive line to help him with a push. He'll go just inside the 10. And let's check in with Mike Adamly again.
Ron, the other thing about Robert Edwards, he was the last player signed in Georgia's 1993 recruiting class. Ray Goff, who also coached Tim Worley, Herschel Walker, Garrison Hurst, and Nate Lewis, says that Robert's speed, 4-4 in the 40, is the equal of people like Herschel Walker's. And matter of fact, his teammates have taken the calling Robert this week Hirsch and Walk. So indeed, high praise for this young man.
Hines Ward comes into the backfield. They use him as a receiver many times. Pass in the flat, though. Simpson right through his hand. I don't know if that was deflected or not by Godfrey, but it was. It looked as though it was right there.
George Kidd either got a hand on it or he distracted the receiver because he was able to get his hands up in the air.
So Cannon Parkman will come on to attempt this field goal. They'll place it down at the 16, and it will be a 26-yard attempt trying to put Georgia on top, 10-7. No problem for him. So let's take a break. The Georgia Bulldogs touched the football twice, and in the first 8 minutes, they have scored a field goal and a touchdown. Right back. Nino Sylvan, he'll get a chance to return it from the six. Shows you why he's one of the best in the nation. Reggie Smith on the tackle. It's a 25-yard return. It out over the 45 to the 46. Corey Johnson on the stop, and that's going to be a 16-yard run.
Ron, you like to give credit to offensive lineman Bubba Miller, the big center, the captain of this football team, 6'1", 285, with a big block on that play.
He told me on Thursday his mom's not going to be here tonight. He said, tell her hi if you can. Bubba's one of the low-key guys. He doesn't give himself a lot of credit. He thinks that Jason Lehman and Ratliff and Jeff Smith have more athletic ability than he does. But the coaches say he's stretching that a little bit, but he works very, very hard. Got a man in a streak route, just overthrown, Joey Kent. And that's a very difficult pass to throw. Got to be perfect.
It is, but the impressive thing to me is tonight so far that Peyton Manning's making every read right. You're talking about a young quarterback's only a sophomore, and they have so many weapons, Ron, that they can run the football, that big offensive line. And you look at his pass chart, everything under 15 yards he's hit. He hit that big post down the middle one-on-one, just missed that one on the outside, but he's been near perfect.
That's his first miss.
Near perfect.
Swings this one out. Has his tight end, David Horn. Horn gets blasted at the 50-yard line. It's going to be third down and 5. Alunda Sims, he's a transfer from Marshall, is the defensive back who makes the hit.
Good ball fake by Peyton Manning. That holds the linebackers. Dumps the ball out to his tight end, Horn.
Well, that's the end of the first quarter with our score, Georgia 10 and Tennessee 7. Robert Edwards shaken up. They put some tape on top of his shoe. Here are his numbers. 98 yards. He had the loss a moment ago, which took him from over 100. And Mike Adamly, what do you have for us on the injury?
Ron, the word right now on Robert Edwards, a sprained left foot. They're going to wait until halftime, I think, to evaluate it. So he may not get back in here in the first half. And Cannon Parkman following George's field goal to make it 10-7. Sprained his right knee on the ensuing kickoff, so he too could be doubtful.
Boy, and the special teams for Georgia have really been outstanding. it complete inside the 40. It's Marcus Nash. Good for 12 yards.
It's pitch and catch for Tennessee right now. They're spreading the field with their different formations. Peyton Manning sitting right in there, reading the secondary like a veteran. Finds Marcus Nash on an out route right in front of Kirby Smart for the big completion.
Kirby Smart had 3 sacks last week for Georgia. They use him as an extra defensive back from time to time. Graham hit hard at the line of scrimmage. It's Whit Marshall, the senior out of Atlanta, 6'2", 238.
He's a middle linebacker. He's the senior signal caller that makes it go for this Georgia defense. Makes all the calls in their fronts, makes all the calls of the stunts and the blitzes.
And after graduation, he'll continue to make the calls as a consumer economics major. 13 minutes in, going under 13 until halftime. This is the 11th play of the drive for Tennessee. All alone on the short side of the field as David Horn is tied in. He'll sneak inside the 10-yard line, and it's first and goal, Tennessee. To penetrate the 5-yard line. Then a nice job by Jason Ferguson, the junior out of Nettleton, Mississippi, a defensive tackle, making the stop on him.
He's running behind Jeff Smith, number 74, the right guard. Leslie Ratliff, the right tackle, 75. Good movement that they get. There's number 36, Whit Marshall, making the first contact on Jay Graham.
Offensive line combining for 134 starts.
And the great thing about that, Ron, is they're experienced. They know the calls. They know what they're doing.
Horn in motion. It's Graham. You see him pull the tackle at the 1-yard line. Wow, that's a pretty good stick. Whit Marshall. Well, Whit came up and really put a hat on him along with Corey Johnson and denied him the end zone.
Corey Johnson, the coaches from Georgia, said pound for pound, maybe our best football player. He makes a big play here on the counter play. Number 74, Jeff Smith, Leslie Ratliff, 75 on the pull. There's number 27, Corey Johnson, with a tackle that saved the touchdown.
Third down, Tennessee. The ball just inside the Georgia 2. Receiving end. Mike, that is an extremely difficult play to make going against the grain.
Excellent job by Peyton Manning. And you were talking about his speed, but let me tell you something. His speed is fast enough.
Yep.
Because Buster Owens was coming from that backside, number 3, on a corner blitz, but he could not get to Peyton Manning. Some quarterbacks have a feel of where the defensive guy is. It looked like Peyton Manning had an understanding of when he needed to throw that football to Ronnie Pillow.
Jeff Hall. Knocks it home, and with 11:03 left until halftime, Tennessee 14, Georgia 10. Again, Hunter and Daniels back to receive the kick from Jeff Hall. Daniels and Atelli, nope, don't come out. Bobo on the flat on the other side. And Boy will have the first down as he'll take it to the 36-yard line. Terry Fair knocked his feet out from under him, but good for 14.
Mike Bobo's been impressive also tonight, along with Peyton Manning. Underneath, you see what he's doing there. He's having great success underneath, under 15 yards, and he's had 2 big strikes against this Tennessee pass defense.
Zaire got hurt last year in the Georgia Tech game, and he played. He said that really helped his confidence and the confidence of his teammates that he could do the job.
Said he had his jacket on. Never thought he was going to go into the game, so he didn't really have time to worry about it.
Probably the reason he played so well. Good stick right up the middle as Kurtzy gets blasted back. Craig King and Gallion are there to combine on the stop.
Talk about Eric Zier. He's missed here at the University of Georgia, but they're a more balanced offensive football team this year. In the coaching at the University of Georgia, Greg Davis, the quarterback coach, Eric Zier was prepared from the day he got to the Cleveland Browns. He's had an excellent preseason camp up there.
5-yard penalty assessed against Georgia a moment ago for illegal substitution. They broke the huddle with 12 men, one coming off the field. You can't deceive the defense, and Al Ford and the group caught him. Bobo hit from behind, and he's sacked by Shane Burton.
I think Mike Bobo made a good decision there, Ron. His protection broke down, but the route was well covered. He could have put the ball up and maybe you've gotten it picked off. Pressure's coming from the outside. Shane Burton, number 84, just beats the block. And then up Troy Stark, 75, sacks Mike Bobo. But a good decision by Mike Bobo not to put it up in the air.
First time that he's been sacked tonight, and it's third down. They got to take this one all the way out to the 47 to hold on to the football. Hit just as he unloads it. That was Leonard Little running after the ball, but it was Steve White who separated him from the football.
We talked early about the big line splits. Tennessee's taking advantage with some good moves. Down lineman moves, blitz, running linebackers through and taking advantage. Steve White is a playmaker. Quick, good size. Here's the move. Comes inside from the backside, beat Rusty Beatles, number 70.
Sheldon to receive this punt from Langley. Gets by one. And now here comes a late flag in. 45 yards in the kick. Buster Owens downfield to make the stop, but it's 13 on the return.
I'll meet up with you.
Graham takes it to the right side. Almost has five on the plate. Greg Bright will trip him up. Now rushing yards, Georgia 109 and Tennessee 59. It quieted somewhat. First quarter, they were absolutely going crazy up and down the field.
Well, we're missing Robert Edwards. Mm-hmm. After he left the football field, Georgia could not run the ball anymore successfully. Well, they need him back in the game.
It took that tape off his shoe. I have to believe it probably they took the stocking off and taped his ankle rather than the shoe. And now one flag and a second flag. Sims and Corey Johnson were out there. And let us wait and see.
Face mask on the defense. 5 yards tacked on to the end of the run. First down.
With Robert Edwards out, you see a more aggressive Tennessee defense. They've had one sack on Mike Bobo, and then they hit him in the back the other time. So without Robert Edwards in there, it's tee off time by that defense.
Sure does make a difference. The roadmap looks different. From Eric Lane to pave the way, and he's close to the first down.
This has been an impressive first half of hitting. Both these teams, well coached, playing a great first half in an intense football game.
Manning trying to get everybody to get lined up as they move the change. Clock is running with 1:50 until halftime. Back to the sideline, and Horn is just unattended out there.
Talked about Peyton Manning. Almost been perfect. The 0-for-3 in the left corners is the only problem he's had. He's been he's done everything right tonight, Ron. He's made every read right, and he still has three timeouts with 1:45 left on the clock.
Goes the sideline route. Woo. Greg Bright was closer to the pass than was David Horn. Got a little anxious on that one.
Joe Kine said Greg Bright, number 45, he has good eyes and knows where the ball is all the time. Made a good play on that against Peyton Manning's pass.
And now a timeout called by Tennessee with 1:40 showing on the clock, and we'll hold it right here. It's only five misses for Peyton out of 20, 212 yards. So the ball's out of the huddle into the line of scrimmage, and looks like we'll finally get this third down play done. At the 25 and down to the 23, Maurice Staley. And Mike, he's been very impressive in this first half.
He really has been impressive. He's made three or four catches tonight, been tough catches. And Peyton Manning's doing a nice job of looking off the receivers and looking off the defensive backs to hit Staley.
And as you could see in that tight shot of Peyton, it is now beginning to rain hard here in Knoxville. Boy, Marcus Nash had a little bit of a pick out there and had him open, and he just dropped it.
They're spreading the field, Ron. They've got excellent pass protection. That give the offensive line credit. Tennessee still with one timeout left, 1:23 on the clock. Ray Goff wanted to pick on that last play, but didn't get it. He felt like there was a pick by the Tennessee receivers.
He was close to right. They go with the draw play. A nice defensive work. As stepping up is Jason Ferguson. That's a couple of tackles for the backup there at left tackle. And he stops him for virtually no gains.
Phil Kynes felt that Jason Ferguson could be a special player. He said he hadn't said two words since he got here. He's a junior college transfer, just arrived in the fall.
Manning swings it out to Graham, rights himself, stiff arm, and as you can see, that's Buster Owens, who will knock him down just short of the 15.
Good play by the defensive backs, keeping the ball in front of them. They know where the chains are, and they know they want to force the field goal attempt. Buster Owens with a good tackle.
Mike, in watching his eyes, Manning I'm speaking of, it almost looked as though that Graham was either his third or maybe even his fourth receiver.
I think he was looking for Nash first on the outside because he had him working against Randall Godfrey, and then he was able to come off. Good quarterback can come off his first read, go to the second, and then to his third. Ron, I think the big question of this first half in all Georgia fans' minds is, what's going to happen with Robert Edwards? Can we get him back on the field? Because it's such a big momentum changer for him to be hurt and be out of this ball game. They need him back on the field.
So time is back in. 13 seconds left until halftime. And the field goal attempt, 32 yards. That's a good pass, and he knocks it home. 32 yards in the field goal. So that is the end of the first half with our score. Tennessee 17 and Georgia 10. Now let's join Mike Tirico for the GMAC halftime report. Back in Knoxville, 17 to 10, our halftime score, Tennessee on top. And the first half story is very easy. Edwards, 107 rushing yards. All other Georgia running backs, zero, Mike.
Ron, it's a story here. He makes a cutback, goes in for the touchdown on the cutback. Got great vision. Here's a long run. At the end of this run, you're going to see him use his strength, try to stiff arm the defensive back to get extra yardage. And on our third play, you're going to see him. This is the injury. Shane Burton, number 84, is going to come in your screen, tackle him, and there's where he was injured. Big loss for the Georgia team.
107 yards for him and everybody else, zero. So, boy, that speaks more than volumes. I mean, that's it. Nine rushes, 107.
I think that's one of the stories. The other story is Peyton Manning played so well in that first half.
Longley kicking off, replacing Parkman, who injured his knee in that first half. Sylvan fumbled it, now gets it up. At the 20-25, he's one of the best in the nation. At the 30, at the 20 of Georgia, and shoved out of bounds just inside the 15-yard line. Yards on the kick return.
What he did to Ron was he hit the middle You're going to see him on the kickoff return. He catches a football. Now he hits the middle. Now he breaks to the left side. There's the middle. Now he breaks to the side. Now here's where he does a great job. He lets his blocker set up. He picks up about 10 more yards by just letting his blocker set up. Craig King, number 44, with a big block for him. He gets about 10, 15 more yards.
Well, Nilo Sylvan, number one of the SEC in returns. And after this one tonight, he may be number one in the nation.
Special teams.
Graham to the left side. Tripped up. That's a nice job by Greg Bright to make the stop. And let's check in with Mike Adamley.
Well, Rod, as we said in the first half, he has a sprained midfoot on his left foot, Robert Edwards. What they've done is put a steel shank in his left shoe, and hopefully that will give him a little more support. Now, when Georgia gets the ball back on offense, he will play, at least try to. But as he walked out here for the start of the second half, he was walking very gingerly.
Okay, Mike, thanks for the update. Second down, the running play goes to the right side. And a reminder that every 10, 30, and 50 minutes after the hour, ESPN will update you as we are right now on the scores from around the country. Opening minute of play in the second half is Nilo Sylvan just exploded. And Mike, how many times have you seen it on special teams where a guy will fumble a ball and the return team will kind of break down for a moment rather than stay in their lane?
They just relax a little bit and run on that kickoff return. Buster Owens, number three from Georgia, defensive back, was hurt, so he's not in the ball game.
Yeah. Pressure coming up the middle, out of the backfield, threw it a little bit quickly to Ronnie Pillow, but he had pressure on him, and Manning had to get rid of it.
Good call by Joe Kines, defensive coordinator. He brought Randall Gottfried, number 42, his playmaker and his All-American linebacker. He forced the play. Peyton Manning looking. Here's Randall Gottfried just in his face enough to cause him to throw the ball away.
So Hall to attempt the field goal. It'll be placed down at the 14 for a 24-yard attempt as Tennessee trying to go up by 10. So Tennessee on top now by a count of 20-10. As that big kickoff return, they jumped up and bit Georgia for three. And they're fortunate it wasn't seven. Juan Daniels, number 12, along with Bryce Hunter, the dual safety for the Bulldogs. But both of these guys are capable of doing the same thing. Daniels says, "I want it." Bryce Hunter, beg your pardon. And he will come up to the 28-yard line. 23 on the return. Edwards, we'll see if he, well, he didn't get around the corner quite as fluidly that time. Raymond Austin.
Looking at his injured foot, left foot, looks like he's limping a little bit. Robert Edwards has the corner, but Raymond Austin, number 28, free safety, a really aggressive free safety, is able to come up and make that play, save it to about a 3-yard gain.
Standing next to Bobo. Tip, and he caught it. Juan Daniels came down with the football.
Ran a go switch on the outside. On the outside, Mike Bobo's going to look to his outside receiver, number 12, Juan Daniels, running up the sideline. Ball's put right on the money by Mike Bobo, and an excellent catch by Juan Daniels. He took it away from the defensive back.
He did take it away from him. 20-10, Tennessee leads. And we got confusion on this play.
The only one that could have caught that's the official, but Leonard Little caused that whole mess. He is rushing the passer relentlessly, number one for Tennessee.
Mike, I kind of wanted to start humming the old Supreme song, "Nowhere to Run to, Baby, Nowhere to Hide." Whoa. Second down, line to make, is the 24.
They like Bryce Hunter as the inside receiver on this play, working him against the linebacker.
Gets his pass away. Had a man there, Hunter, just as you were talking about.
Just threw it too far, Ron. Had him open on the corner route. Mike Bobo's father's a coach, coached at Thomasville as a head coach, and he moved closer to Athens so he could be closer to his son. Gave up his job. Coaching at a smaller school.
And he had a great job down in Georgia, the one that he left.
It was a great one, but he said he wanted to be close to his son.
Third down. He's got it. Matt Dixon caught the pass, and Georgia will move the chains with a gain of 13.
Caught him one-on-one. Matt Dixon with Terry Fair, number 13, just hit him on the short, skinny post right in front of Terry Fair. It's going to be a skinny post against Terry Fair. Just right on the break, the ball's thrown by Mike Bobo. Couldn't have thrown it any better and timed better. Big drive for Georgia. Run.
Kirksey gets the handoff, takes it right up the middle. He'll squeeze it for a couple. And Mike, as an old disc jockey, I want to make sure I get this right. I'm standing there saying, that's not the Supremes. It's Martha and the Bandellas who say, nowhere to run to, nowhere to hide. Enough already. 20-10, Tennessee leads with 8:40 to play, third quarter.
Robert Edwards out of the ball game again, Ron, in this late drive here.
Kirksey gets the handoff, and behind just a host of blockers, he takes it inside the 15. Leonard Little is down there on the bottom of that stack. So it's going to be third down, and the Dogs need the 11-yard line to keep it alive.
You're looking upstairs as a coach right now, and that last play, Mike Bobo gave that ball off to the halfback, but he was wide open on a naked, so if somebody up here looks at that, they're going to dial that one up a little bit later where Mike Bobo can come out, make that fake, and come out with the naked play and throw the ball.
Got Hunter, first and goal, Georgia at the 5. Ty Hines will wrap him up.
I know I keep saying it, Ron, but I tell you, these two quarterbacks tonight, when you started the ball game, you wondered how much they were going to be able to handle. Hey, they've handled it all. They've attacked this field. It's in their hands now. With Robert Edwards hurt, it's in Mike Bobo's hands, and it's been in Peyton Manning's hands all night. But Mike Bobo has been impressive.
Two sophomores that
they're going to be around
show,
for a while.
Yeah, show more than their years as far as poise and experience. Edwards back in the lineup, number 47. Tries to get around the corner, and they will stop him at the 2. That's Raymond Austin, who got out there to make the hit on Robert Edwards.
Raymond Austin is so fast at filling from that free safety spot. He's an aggressive free safety, the junior.
He had 9 tackles last week to lead this ball club.
And you wonder if Robert Edwards is healthy here if he gets the corner turned, but Raymond Austin will not allow him to turn that corner.
Looked as though he was galloping a little bit, and that
not
gate was,
loose.
Yeah, was very smooth when he was healthy in the first half. Edwards, skyward, touchdown Bulldog.
Just his presence on the field helps that entire football team of Ray Goff. They're excited on the sidelines. They know that he gives you a chance on offense to make the plays. Gutty effort by Robert Edwards.
Good blocking by David Weeks and Paul Taylor up front. And just like that, with just over 7 minutes to play in the third quarter, Georgia right back in this one. Langley to attempt the extra point with the injured Parkman. And he got it. So as we head to break, one more look at the touchdown by Robert Edwards. It is Tennessee 20 at the Georgia Bulldogs 17. 13 plays, 72 yards, 6 minutes and 11 seconds. And Robert Edwards takes it in for the touchdown.
Ron, Tennessee gift-wrapped him the play when they got that 12 men on the field call because that kept that drive alive.
Now this is Langley kicking off because of the injury to Parkman. He did not get it deep enough to go in the end zone, and Sylvan got a return last time, and he's going to try again. Better job by Georgia on that return, but 28 yards on the return.
Every play the same way.
Pass out of the backfield, tipped, and it will go incomplete. His horn turned around and tried to make the reception. He was tipped by who else? Godfrey.
Randall Godfrey wasn't faked out by the play action, was able to stretch out and get his hands on that football.
You know, the story in Georgia is, as you look at it one more time, is that Vinny Testaverde had a different kind of illness. He had a Zyrus. Put him down. Swings it out of the backfield. And Levine is going to take it up to the 36-yard line. Greg Bright makes the stop on him.
Last year, this Georgia defensive football team stayed on the field too long. As you talked about earlier, Ron, that the two things they wanted to improve this year was their defense against the run, and they wanted to run the football better. And I think they've accomplished that here in the early going of the season. It's a better Georgia football team. This man has helped Joe Kimes.
Manning sacked back at the 15-yard line. Frank Watts, first time they've gotten to him tonight, but what a big play right here for Georgia.
Ron, credit Joe Kimes again. I want to keep talking about him, but remember early in the game, he was rotating 10 people with defensive linemen. They're fresh right now. Frank Watts just came off the mark and beat that block and sacked Peyton Manning. So the substitution plan has helped this Georgia defense.
That's a loss of 14 yards, so Georgia stands to get very good field position. Binion to kick it away, and Chris McCraney, who had a 41-yard return last week against South Carolina, is the man who's back to receive it. And he's going to get one on this one. So let's take a break. 5:29 left in the third quarter. Georgia has pulled back to within three. Cobb trying to get aroused here and help this Tennessee defense. Edwards sweeps the right. Has five, has 10, counted off at 11 yards as Corey Gaines will put the stopper on him.
Confidence just rises in this Georgia football team when 47 Robert Edwards is on the field. Bill Lewis gave me a statistic up here. Since 1971, Georgia is 27-43-3. Not very good when their passing total exceeds their rushing total. Georgia wants to become a running football team again.
Well, in this conference, you better be able to run the football or you don't get very far.
You better run it and stop the run.
Edwards on the cutback. Three at the 30. And goes down at the 23-yard line. Mike, was he tackled or did he go down because of that injury? 25 yards in the play and he is still down.
See, turn the corner, Ron. I think you're right, Ron. He just went down.
Wow, that's... Which means that he probably injured it a little more. But you can see the pain gets him. He's kind of in a different gait right here. And just as he makes that cut right there.
You know what's important? He doesn't look like he's moving fast, but Deron Jenkins came up and his angle was wrong because Robert Edwards just kind of left him. The statistics, 15 rushes, 155 yards, and when he's not in there, they can't run the football.
Bowie out front blocking. Gets his block, and Kirksey just tripped up. Gallion got enough of his ankle to knock him off balance.
I've talked about this all night, though, but when he's not in the field, Tennessee plays differently on defense because the threat's gone. Now, obviously, Torrin Kirksey's a very good tailback,
but he's not Robert Edwards. And when Robert Edwards is not on that field, that Tennessee defense gains some confidence also, does a little bit different, challenges that Georgia offense a little bit more.
Randall Godfrey, always the team guy. He cares tremendously. He's back checking on the wounded tailback. Bobo for the end zone, and it's caught to the touchdown, Ron Daniel.
And what was impressive about that play, Ron, is Mike Bobo was looking to the front side. He was trying to work his tight end and his back in the flat. He came off of a late by Juan Daniels, put it right there where Juan Daniels made a great catch on this Georgia football team. He is an improved football team from last year.
Langley doesn't either. He knocks it downtown, and there's a timeout on the field with 4:14 left to play in the third. We'll hold it right here as Georgia has gone back on top.
Mike Bobo, you see, was looking to the right side. This comes out like a ducko, but it gets to where it's going to Juan Daniels. Now, Juan Daniels was looking at his route against Terry Fair, number 13. Skinny post again. What I mean by that, he breaks it right to the goal post. Juan Daniels leaps in the air, looks that football into his hands, and Georgia's got the lead. We talk about answering the score. Peyton Manning's up to that challenge. This Tennessee offense hasn't had a real clean second half offensively yet.
But it got off to a rocky start. They had the long return, and then they had to call the timeout because they were lined up wrong. Going to bring this one out, Milo Sylvan. Manning all day, has it complete. Wow, there's your hit of the night. Good heavens, Godfrey just unloaded on Marcus Nash.
That's what you expect your great players to do, make plays like that to ignite your defense. Randall Godfrey on Marcus Nash, number 12.
Hard to believe it, Marcus held on to it. Good job by him, sophomore out of Tulsa. Running play for 6-7, close to 8. Armin Love on the stop, but Graham will have the first down. And Tennessee will move the chains.
This substitution plan of Georgia on defense and what they're trying to do on offense. Last week, Georgia trailed South Carolina 17-7 in the third quarter and just took over the game in the second half. They trailed here 20-10 and look like they're getting a second breath here also. Good substitution plan by Ray Goff.
Rams good cutback. 5, 10, 15, had it off at 22 yards on the run. Corey Johnson made the stop. Armin Love also helped out.
One of Steve Marshall's offensive linemen, Trey Peterson, number 73, came off the mark and had a good block.
Now they're going to say officially 22 yards on that carry. Got him over the middle. Joey Kent, and he is going to have the Tennessee first down. How about that? 21 yards in the pass play.
There's a lot of SEC defensive coordinators are going to lose a lot of sleep tonight worrying about how they're going to stop these two teams. This play was set up again by Peyton Manning's good fake. Joey Kent, the best receiver on this football team, makes the catch.
You know, Bubba Miller made a good point when I visited with him on Thursday. He said, the thing that we have to always be cognizant of, we have so much confidence in Peyton, but he's only an early sophomore. He's still very young.
He's carried the weight of this offensive football team tonight.
Quick out pass. That's Marcus Nash, and he'll wrap him up. Maybe a gain of one. Buster Owens is there.
Didn't cover the receiver out there. They had an inside technique against him, and Peyton Manning just raises up and throws the football. Peyton Manning's passing chart, he's had a great football game.
We're about to go under 1 minute left in the third quarter. 21 of 29 for Manning. Hey, fake the draw and throw the pass complete at the 16-yard line. Joey Kent again.
When you look at quarterbacks, you look at footwork, you look at arm strength, you look at vision, and one thing that's underrated sometimes is ball handling. This ball handled right here where he faked the ball, held the defensive backs right in check. And that ball handling, a Boomer Esiason type player in the pros who takes a lot of pride in his ball handling. Peyton Manning understands faking the football.
Horn in motion. They throw back over the middle. Scott Kent for the touchdown. Jeff Hall tries to keep his extra point string alive. And he's right down the middle.
How many times can you say ball handling, the thing that sets up a good quarterback? Peyton Manning, so young yet so experienced, fakes the sprint draw, turns, gets his feet moved, gets his hips behind him, gets the ball in action, the post route to Joey Kent, completely faked the safety out. There's no underneath help because of the ball fake. Touchdown, Tennessee. What Peyton Manning is saying is, ball's back in your court, Mike Bobo.
Yards deep in the end zone. He will not return it. Not many folks are sitting at this stadium right now. 96,000 as Edwards is up even. He wants to get a better vantage point and see what happens by his Georgia teammate. Curtsy, good. Heavens, what a hit. Oh, my goodness. I believe Gallion is the man who hit him first, and he really rocked him back.
Scott Gallion, in a conversation I had with him yesterday in the dormitory, he was talking about how 90% of the players stayed here this summer, worked out, and they had a chance to visit and talk about goals, and he said they really became close in the summer.
That's going to be the final play of the third quarter. They are standing and cheering here in Knoxville. That's the end of the third quarter with our score. Tennessee 27, Georgia 24. Well, there's Parkman injured his kicking leg in that first half. Kurtsey breaks one tackle. Won't get out of the grasp of the second, and it's Jonathan Brown who finishes him off.
Look for big plays in the ball game. Remember this play by Greg Bright, linebacker number 45. He's going to take on the block of the fullback, Chester Ford, number 20. Now he's going to come out and just get his hand up and make the tackle on Jay Graham to force Tennessee to punt that football.
Well, particularly if Georgia comes back and wins this football game, you do have to put an asterisk by that one. Get the screen pass. Kurtzy, nice move in the open field. He'll have the Georgia first down out of the 23. Shane Burton got him.
We watched Georgia last year in a couple games that you'll remember. The Alabama game where they had Alabama beaten, couldn't just put them away. And the Auburn game last year where they tied Auburn and broke that streak. And so Ray Goff has been in some close ball games, and one day they're going to turn for him.
Down again, hurdles the tackler, puts a 5, now 6 yards more to the 49. Bear tripped him up.
I'll tell you, just the quarterbacks, what else? I'm not Mike Bobo with good ball handling. The ball out to Larry Boyd. mean, they have answered the call tonight, both these young quarterbacks.
Yeah, I think you're right on. Kurt C. showing some gutsy running. He's not real big at 6 feet 180. They're very resilient and spun inside that tackle, avoiding a full contact.
Ron, when you lose a player like Robert Edwards, somebody has to pick it up. Mike Bobo's picked it up. But I would expect either Bryce Hunter or Juan Daniels to come up with some kind of big play if Georgia's going to win this football game.
Good heavens, what a hit by Leonard Little. He stepped up and hit Percy just as soon as he got the football.
Looked like he came inside. Big splits again. Leonard Little, number one, just steps in and steps out in front of Rusty Beatles. Number 70 makes the tackle.
It's the Tennessee 41 yard.
Here's his key receivers, Bryce Hunter, Juan Daniels right here, the two inside receivers.
Right over the middle, he's got it. Bryce Hunter, first and 10, Georgia. And they're going to spot it just shy of the 35-yard line.
Working against the nickelback, Steve Johnson, number 34. Gave him a little shake and bake and broke to the inside. 88, Bryce Hunter. There's the old shake and bake, and now he's got him beat. He's got him on his hip. Steve Johnson, Mike Bobo with the delivery, and now they're 7 out of 13 on third downs.
Takes it to Kersey. Grabbed it in the flat to Boy. He'll have another Georgia first down. He'll take it to the 22-yard line. Terry Fair puts the stop on him.
You're seeing the emergence of a star tonight in Mike Bobo, because he has really, once Robert Edwards left the game, it's all on his shoulders. Now, he has responded, as has Peyton Manning on the other side, but you're seeing the making of a very, very good quarterback in Mike Bobo. See his pass chart. There's not many incompletions, not many mistakes in that passing chart for Mike Bobo tonight.
17 of 27, 258 yards. New running back, Odell Collins, a junior out of Jefferson, Georgia, gets the call, and he will take it for a gain of about four.
It's a bigger back for Georgia. Junior college player that they feel like's not quite ready yet. But they needed to force him into the ball game in this action tonight with Robert Edwards out.
Odell is 6'3", 240 pounds. Going to be tripped up by Craig King, and that is an awfully big play because Georgia is now looking at a third down and about five.
Third and five. Now, if you're Mike Bobo, you want to get the first down, but you don't want to make your first mistake tonight and turn this football over, because you've got a possibility of a three. But Ray Goff's not thinking three now. He's thinking victory. He wants seven on this play.
Remember, it was Tennessee back in the first half in this very area of the field that turned over a ball back to Georgia. It looked like a sure touchdown, if not a field goal. Over the middle, and he dropped it. Threw it just a little bit behind Bryce Hunter. And he knows it. That's the reason he's grabbing his headgear.
Just threw it a little bit too low.
So, we're going to have a try for a field goal. And as we had mentioned, Parkman has the injury to his leg, so it's going to be Dex Langley who will attempt a 35-yarder trying to tie this one up. Got the distance, and he has the accuracy, and we are tied with 4:51 left in this ball game.
What a drive by Georgia. Mike Bobo did everything he could ask him to do. The last pass a little low, but he set him up for the game-tying field goal. And you talk about fantastic finishes, 4:51 on this clock, Ron. We've got a nice one here. Ron, my main concern if I was Ray Goff here is I would not kick that ball to Nilo Sylvan unless I kicked it out of the end zone.
Yeah, that's an excellent point. Sylvan, as we have mentioned, the national statistical leader and also the SEC leader. And boy, he did just that.
That's
he knocked it out of the back. So the situation, 4 minutes, 51 seconds to play. We're tied at 27. Cut it back in the middle. Does. Has 5, 7, 8, and now 9 yards. Second down and short. And it's Graham, and he squeezes through an opening. He'll have 6 yards in the new first down. Now, this is the kind of drive that I know that Phil Fulmer would love to have. Just eat the clock up, let there be nothing left, either get the touch or get the field goal. Graham now 26 carries, 125 yards. He had 144 last week, and that was the most ever by any Tennessee running back in their first start. And that covers some awfully good people. Nilo Sylvan just dropped it.
Timeouts remaining for Tennessee and Georgia. Both have two. With 3:50 on the clock.
Well, we saw Bryce Hunter. His pass was a little bit behind him, but he dropped one a moment ago, and now Sylvan has a ball that's in his hands and couldn't come up with it. Corner blitz coming from Georgia. Tennessee picks it up, and the pass incomplete. Marcus Nash that they were trying to get to, and I believe that was tipped by Godfrey.
That's what Randall Godfrey was telling you in your conversation with him yesterday. Joe Kynes isn't going to sit back. He's forcing the action. We're going to throw the first punch. Randall Godfrey, number 43, just starting inside. Now he scrapes down the line of scrimmage, reads the eyes of Peyton Manning, got his hand on the football.
Sure did. 7 of 12 on third down conversions, but 0 for their last three. Joe Kynes, almost careful here. Manning avoids the rush, now gets it away, and it is intercepted. Kirby Smart for Georgia, and he will step out of bounds just inside the 40-yard line, and now flags everywhere.
Peyton Manning was sliding to the left, Ron, and just couldn't get enough on the football and put it up for grabs. Kirby Smart with the interception.
After the interception, on the run back. A block in the back by the white team. It'll be first down and 10 after the penalty.
So there was youth right there trying to get too much.
Here's Peyton Manning. Pressure by Joe Kynes' defense again. Now he starts to move to the left, but see, couldn't get anything on it, Ron, because he's shuffling over there, couldn't get his hips into the ball, couldn't follow through. Ball hung up there for Kirby Smart to intercept it. And you're right, that penalty plays a big part, too. The youth of a football team getting that 10-yard penalty, taking him out inside the 40 to back past the 45.
3 minutes and 34 seconds left. You're tied at 27. Churchill. Gets the pitch. He'll take it for a couple of tough ones. Leonard Little, undoubtedly, the cobwebs are out. He's back in the lineup and makes the stop. Ray Goff, you see his record against Tennessee, 0-4.
I don't buy any of those statistics. I'm going to tell you something. This guy can coach. And he's got a staff that can coach. And anybody wants to criticize him, they're criticizing the wrong guy. This team can coach, and they've got players that believe in this system right now.
Bobo to the pass. Bryce Hunter has it complete. Now, it depends from where that linesman has come down across the way. That's going to be enough for the first down by a half yard.
Extra effort, and we talk about somebody has to step it up with Robert Edwards off the field. Mike Bobo gets a low snap under pressure, delivers that ball with Steve White right in his face. Bryce Hunter makes the catch, then the extra effort to try to get the first down. You would expect that out of Bryce Hunter. He's a senior.
And they say officially, it is a first down. Clock runs, 2:39, now 2:38. Tennessee 27 and Georgia 27.
It's been a whale of a football game. These fans have got their money's worth tonight.
Kurtzy hit very hard as he tries the left side. It's Gallion along with Tyrone Hines.
John Chavis, the defensive coordinator at Tennessee, he's not going to sit back either now. He's going to blitz his linebacker, Tyrone Hines, number 47, the middle linebacker, started 8 games last year. He just on a blitz read, made the tackle, and John Chavis said he gave us a boost after the Florida game last year. We started him, and he made a difference in the defense.
Clock is at 1:48, now 1:47. Pass incomplete. Receiver slipped down. That was Juan Daniels, but it was thrown behind him, and it'll stop the clock at 1:39.
Ron, if it comes down to a long field goal, Bill Lewis, the coach of Georgia Tech last year, just handed me this. Dax Langley kicked a 63-yard field goal in high school. It's the all-time record in the state of Georgia. He broke the record of 58 yards held by, guess who? His teammate, Kenneth Parker.
I'll tell you what, Mike, if this thing stalls, he's going to have about a 53-yarder to kick here. Third down, line to make, is the 26 of Tennessee. Over the middle, Bryce Hunter dropped it. I don't believe he did that. Hit him in the hands, and he dropped it, and he had cut in front of the defensive back. Mike, he might have even had big yardage downfield.
Now it's decision time for Ray Goff. You're right. That ball should have been caught. And number two's coming out.
So let's mark off the seven. It's going to be around 53 yards, this attempt to put Georgia on top by a count of 30 to 27.
Well, he hit that 60-yarder now that he hit in high school.
Brian Smith is the holder, number 11. Kick is on its way. Does it have the distance? Yes, and it is off to the right and no good.
I like the decision by Ray Goff, but it gives field position to Tennessee, but Ray Goff scored for the victory, so you got to like that out of the Georgia coach. Just off to the right.
Well, Bobo has been super tonight. Let's see if Peyton Manning can bring his club back with 1:29 left.
He gets another chance, Ron, after that interception.
Swings it out in the flat. That's Graham. Breaks the tackle, and he's up the sideline. Knocked out of bounds around the 35-yard line. Godfrey got him. Don't go away. Tennessee is right back. It's a 28-yard game.
Randall Godfrey had to make this play on Jay Graham. Jay Graham missed, avoided some defensive players. A little swing pass. A good call by David Cutcliffe. Pass now. Make somebody miss. Kirby Smart is a miss. Randall Godfrey makes the play, but Tennessee's knocking on the door.
Here they come with a corner blitz again. Tennessee picks it up. Pass is thrown complete. It'll be a gain of 7 yards to Joey Kent. Again, Kirby Smart. Georgia used that to good advantage last week against South Carolina. In fact, Smart got 3 sacks in that ball game coming off the corner.
Expect Joe Kynes to heat him up right here. Jeff Hall, the place kicker for Tennessee, has also hit a couple 62-yarders in high school.
1:16 to play. Tennessee 27, Georgia 27. Well, how many are coming? Everybody puts it on top.
Just beyond his outstretched hands, looking for Joey Kent. Boy, he laid out for it, didn't he?
Peyton Manning put air under that football for Joey Kent. Bump and run technique. All you can do is throw it to the corner and hope Joey Kent can catch up with it.
Don't forget, kicking off as soon as this ball game is over, Colorado State at Colorado. Third down, straight up the middle, has the first down, and he will take it to the 18-yard line as Phillip Daniels will trip him up.
The loss in this evening is a performance by Jay Graham, also from Tennessee tailback. He's been very steady for this offense. He's running behind Bubba Miller and Trey Peterson here. And now they're set up in that middle of the field with 1:05 left to go on that clock.
Ray Goff looking anxiously at the clock, and here's our situation. 65 seconds left in this ballgame.
Can't criticize any call in this ballgame.
No.
Both these coaching staffs have coached this game the way you want them to coach it, coaching it to win.
Graham just diving to the 15-yard line. You know what else it is a great promo for, Mike? I ran into a man in the lobby this morning and asked me if I had any tickets, and I told him no, but he said, I live in the Northeast. I've never seen a game down south, and I wanted to come. I've heard so much about this spectacle here in the 96,000, and I'm hoping I'm going to get a ticket. I hope the young man got in the ball game tonight, because he may want to come back down and do it again.
Tennessee's now thinking field goal to Jeff Hall, the freshman, and Georgia still has two timeouts, so they may try to ice him as the game goes along.
So there's a timeout on the field, 21 seconds left in the game, tied at 27.
Ron, they're setting it up for Jeff Hall, redshirt freshman, number 4.
You see Hall, the freshman out of Winchester, Tennessee, pacing on the sideline, back and forth. Manning will take it squarely to the middle of the field and go down. So this is going to be an attempt of around 32 or 33 yards by Hall. Mike, if you're Georgia, do you save the timeout, or like in basketball, do you try to ice him?
No, there's no sense in saving it. I don't believe at this point what you do is ice him. Georgia defensive team has come over with Ray Goff and Joe Kynes, trying to figure a way to spring someone up inside, give him a lot of time to think about this.
Crowd will let you know if it's good. 15 seconds left, trying to put Tennessee on top, 30 to 27, and here we go. Jeff Hall. All the celebration, Tennessee has a player who is down at the 15-yard line. We have 10 seconds left on the clock. Immediately, Ray Goff came out on the field, clapping to his team, saying, we still got one more time left here. We got one more effort left. Mike, if you kick it, you're going to squib it, right? Try to hit somebody.
And Georgia needs a return. But remember, they're only three down, so they got to knock it down the field a ways.
Hall probably won't touch the ground in his run to the ball. He's so excited. And I wouldn't blame him. What an experience for a freshman. Sometimes I wonder if we realize how much pressure a kid just out of high school, even though he's a redshirt, 96,000 fans, and he walks out there and just knocks it home. Five yards deep in the end zone. Hunter will go on one knee, so the clock doesn't move.
Well, Peyton Manning, I'm not sure he wanted to look. But a happy sideline with 10 seconds to go. Mike Bobo trying to turn it.
Bobo pass over the middle, has it complete to Hunter. He's tackled in the open field, and they call a timeout with four ticks left on the clock.
Got time for one Hail Mary.
Four ticks left on the clock. Tennessee's got players 60 yards downfield. Bobo's going to throw it for all he's worth. And it is going to be hit and knocked away, and that's the end of our ball game. Jeff Hall is the big man on campus. Tennessee 30, Georgia 27. For Mike Gottfried and Mike Adderley and our entire ESPN crew, Ron Franklin saying so long from Knoxville. Now let's join Brad Nessler and Gary Danielson in Boulder, Colorado.